lo que yo creo que es la sola pregunta. Ok,
great.
De todas formas, en las siguientes charlas vamos a tratar de aterrizar los conceptos que hemos compartido, como para tener respuesta.
It works? Yes. Okay. Hello, everyone. First of all, thanks for being here, because if I come from London, and if we do a meetup on Saturday morning at 10 o'clock in London, no one would show up. Because, I don't know, people there, they don't do meetups on the weekends. So I'm amazed that there's this many people here on a Saturday morning. So my name is Netan Tanel. I'm a development advocate at Google based in London. My role is, I'm basically a software engineer, but instead of working on Google Cloud directly, I learn it, I work with engineers who work on it, and then I come out and talk about it to you, people like you at conferences and meetups to educate people on what we do. And then the other part of my job is to get your feedback. So if you're using Google Cloud, if you're using Kubernetes, if you're using Istio that I'm going to talk about, I want to hear from you, like what you like, what you don't like, or if you don't know anything about it, what you want us to do in terms of training, stuff like that. So I'm trying to be the bridge between engineers at Google and engineers outside Google. So that's kind of my role. This is my Twitter, Netan Tanel. I'm going to put the slides there. So if you want to get the slides, just follow me and you'll have them there. So we're going to be talking about Istio today. But before we talk about Istio, Istio is based on containers and Kubernetes. So I want to know, first of all, who is familiar with containers, like things like Docker, for example? Okay, many people. And who is familiar with Kubernetes? Few people, good. So I'm going to cover containers and Kubernetes briefly so that everyone is on the same page. And once we do that, then I'm going to talk about what Istio is and what kind of stuff it provides to you. So in terms of the agenda, first, we're going to talk about the need for Istio. Why does it even exist? Because in technology, nowadays, there's so many different things that you can learn. So I think it's very important to figure out why you should learn something in the first place. Because we have to pick and choose what we learn. We can't learn everything, right? So the first part of the talk will be that. I don't know what this is. It's iPass. All right. The second part will be what is Istio. So I'm just going to talk about it at a very high level, what it tries to solve, and how do you set it up? So how do you install it? The third part will be building blocks. So Istio is made of something called Envoy. Envoy is a proxy that I'll talk about that Istio is based on, and there's other things like mixers and pilots and Istio auth that basically makes up Istio. So we'll talk about those building blocks. Once you have Istio, the great thing about Istio is that you can add on a lot of things on top of Istio. So you can add on Grafana for dashboards, Prometheus, Zipkin for tracing, Service Graph to see these dependencies between your different microservices. So we'll just take a look at those, see how you can install them, and how you can run them. And then finally, traffic management. So one of the greatest things about Istio is that you can define your network in real time. So you can basically say things like, you know, I want this microservice to call this microservice, but I don't want microservice A to call microservice C. So you can set all these rules, and you can change them on the fly. So as things change in your environment, you can just run a command and change them. So we'll take a look at that. So you can see request routing, you know, look at failure recovery, injection, how you can inject failures into your microservices and see how they behave. Stuff like that. So if you have any questions at any time, feel free to stop me, okay? And if something's not clear, let me know. And if you want us to tell you in Spanish, let them know. Alright, so the need for Istio. First of all, when you solve a problem with software, what do you need? Like, the first thing that you need is the code that solves the problem, right? But that's not the only thing, right? Like, just writing the code to solve the problem is not the only thing you need nowadays. You need to make that code production ready. And you know what production ready means, right? Like, you need to add logging, you need to add tracing, you need to think about authentication, you need to think about load balancing. So there's a lot of things that you need to do on top of your code. And sometimes, actually, like, getting your code production ready can take longer than writing the code itself. You know, I worked in places where I would spend 2-3 weeks to write the code, and maybe another to test it and write the unit test. So I would spend like a month on it, and then I would spend 2 months to make it production ready, because you need to add all these things. You need to integrate it within the environment, so, and you need to make sure that all the tracing and everything works. You need to set up rules for tracing, so if something goes wrong, you get alerts. So this can take a long time, and you need to think about that. And then after that, you need a way to package and run your application in a consistent way. Because nowadays, when you work on microservices, you don't just deploy on a single machine. You probably deploy on a bunch of machines, and you don't assume a single type of machine either. You probably, you might be deploying on machines in your own data center, but you might be deploying in the cloud, so that you don't know the environment. So you need a way to basically package your application in a consistent way and make sure that it runs consistently everywhere you deploy. And then lastly, you need to actually deploy your code, hopefully in an optimal way. So if you have multiple machines, you want to be able to optimally deploy your code. You don't want to put everything on a single machine. You want to make sure that your code is distributed on multiple machines. And you need to also manage it. So once your code is running, you need to make sure that it keeps running. And if the code goes down, or if your code is not running, someone has to watch it and make sure that anyone is created. So these are the kind of things that you need. So when you're a software engineer, it's not about writing code anymore. It's more about writing code and managing in the production, because we are doing DevOps right now. In the past, like 5-6 years ago, you could write your code and just give it to testers and say, test it, you know, because we don't do tests, right? So you would give it to testers, they would test it, and then once everything's working, you would give it to operations people and say, just run it in the production. It wasn't our problem back then, but nowadays with DevOps and everything, we are responsible of the whole chain. So writing the code, testing it, deploying it, and make sure that the code is running. It's all our responsibility. So that's why we have to do all of this. And if you look at what we have today, so the code still comes from you. We have AI coming up, so maybe at some point AI will write our code for us, but we are not there yet. So you still have to write the code. I need to close this. This is my iPad trying to connect to internet. All right. So in terms of packaging and running the code consistently. Oh, come on. Okay, 1 second. I had to quit this guy. Let's kill it. Yep. That's another trick. If something doesn't work, just kill it. Okay. So, in terms of packaging and running the code consistently, that's what Docker is about. Docker, it basically gives you a format to package your application. It also makes sure that package, that format, runs consistently everywhere Docker is running. And in terms of a way to deploy and manage the code, that's what Kubernetes is all about. So, Kubernetes, it gives you a high-level API and a framework to deploy your container in an optimal way and manage it. We'll talk about that in a little bit. And Istio, in my mind, is basically making the code production ready. So you need to add logging, tracing, all these things to your code to make it production ready. That's what Istio does, right? So all these tools, you writing the code, Docker packaging it, Kubernetes deploying and managing the code, and Istio making it production ready. They give you all the tools you need to run microservices in a way that you should be running anyway. Okay, so hopefully that kind of gives you the context for Istio, where it sits in the software development cycle. What is a container? Just to briefly cover it in case people don't know. So a container is just a lightweight way of virtualizing applications. So back in the day, we had physical machines where we deployed applications. Then from physical machines, we went to virtual machines. So the idea of virtual machines is that instead of having a physical machine, you have virtualized operating system, and everything that comes on top of the operating system was virtualized. So that was one way of virtualizing applications. But it was very heavyweight, because you are virtualizing the whole operating system. And these virtual machines, they weren't small, they were gigabytes in size. So they weren't so easy to create, and they were so easy to move around. So what Docker did is that they basically, for containers, they gave us a way to virtualize the process instead of the operating system. So by virtualizing the process itself, you are virtualizing much smaller things. You are virtualizing just the process and its dependencies. And because of it, that it's much easier to create, and it's much easier to move around, right? So instead of having gigabytes of virtual machines, you have megabytes of containers. And then once these are created, you can easily push them to Docker Hub, like a public repository, or you can pull them from Docker Hub or Google Container Repository or something like that. So they're lightweight, they're isolated, so you can have multiple containers running on a single machine. So usually you can have easily tens of containers running on a single virtual machine. They're easy to deploy and easy to introspect, so you can actually get into containers as if they're virtual machines and see what's happening there. So in terms of like management, they look like virtual machines, but they're much more lightweight than virtual machines. And for me, the most important part is they're composable. So what that means is that, imagine this is an image of your application that has some dependencies. So it depends on a base image from Debian. So that's your dependency. This is your image that you build on top. And then if someone else wants to build on top of your application, they can build another image on top. So you can layer your dependencies like that. And each layer is independent, so they can be cached independently. So if you have multiple images depending on the same base image, you only download it once. So things are much more composable than virtual machines. So that's what a container is, in case you haven't realized. And if you're not using them, you should be using them, because that's how things are being packaged around today. And Docker, so what Docker did is basically, it gave us what's called a Docker file. So a Docker file, it's a definition file where you define your environment, your dependencies, and your application. For example, in this case, the Docker file looks like this. It's a very simple one. We are saying from Debian latest. So that says we are depending on the latest image from Debian. So that's our dependency. Then we are installing some packages, so in this case we're installing Nginx. Then we are exposing port 80 in our container. And then we are running a command, so this command is Nginx command. So this is the Docker file that defines the dependency, the environment, and your application. So once you have this, you build an image, and you move the image around, but Docker makes sure that this image runs consistently everywhere. So that's what Docker gives us. Alright, that's good, but containers are not enough by themselves. Because when you run an application in production, first of all, you need redundancy. So you can't just run one container, because what if the container goes down, and your application goes down? So you need to run multiple containers, and you need to manage them yourself. How do you know that your container is running, right? What you need to do is you usually need to create health endpoints in your containers. And someone has to check those health endpoints, make sure your container is running. And if not, someone has to create a new container and edit your cluster. So you need resiliency like that. How do you scale up and down? So let's say you have two containers running, but then you have lots of people using your application, you need to scale up. You need to create more containers, edit your cluster, so you need to scale up. And if the demand goes down, you need to scale down so you can save money. So always scaling up and down, you think about. Rolling out and rolling back. So let's say you're running version 1 for your application and you want to update your code to version 2. How do you update your containers one by one? And how do you do that? In what order? And if something goes wrong, how do you roll back? Right? So there's all these problems that you still need to manage yourself. So just because you took your application and containerized it using Docker doesn't mean that these problems go away. Okay? That's why we have Kubernetes. So Kubernetes, it tries to solve this kind of problems. It tries to give you a framework to manage this kind of problems. So what is Kubernetes? As you can see, it's a Greek word. And let me tell you a secret. Kubernetes is actually mispronounced by everyone. It's true, because it's a Greek word, and I'm originally from Cyprus, where Greek is one of the languages. And the right way of saying Kubernetes is Kubernetes, right? But since Kubernetes came out in the US, and people in the US, they tend to mispronounce things, they mispronounce Kubernetes, and that's where stuck with the name. So yeah, so now you know how to say it properly. And by the way, I gave this talk in Greece once, and I was so happy, because I could tell people, you know how to say it properly, I don't have to tell you. So anyway, Kubernetes, it's an open source project written in Go. At Google, we've been running containers for 10 years, more than 10 years. And we have an internal system called Borg. It's a container management platform that we use internally. And people who work on Borg, they learn from it over the years, and they created Kubernetes for the open source world. So that's where Kubernetes came from. The whole idea of Kubernetes is that instead of thinking in terms of machines, you're thinking in terms of containers and applications. So in Kubernetes, you basically use it to create container clusters, and you think in terms of applications. So you just say deploy this container to some kind of infrastructure you have, but you're not thinking in terms of machines anymore. And for me, the greatest thing about Kubernetes is that it supports multiple cloud providers. So Kubernetes runs on Google Cloud, but it also runs on Azure, it runs on AWS, it can even run on a laptop, so that's the great thing about it. With that, like, if you adopt Kubernetes in your environment, it becomes really easy to move around. So if you want to move to some cloud, it makes it really easy because you're using the same API. So that's what Kubernetes is. The very high level, this is how a Kubernetes cluster looks like. So you have the nodes, so these are the actual machines where you want to deploy containers. If you install Kubernetes yourself, then these will be physical machines. But if you use Kubernetes in Google Cloud, then these will be virtual machines, basically. There's a master that manages these nodes, and the master has an API server where the users can talk to and tell, this is what I want. And then the master will make sure that happens in the nodes. And then there's etcd that manages the cluster, so that's the cluster state. There's a scheduler that figures out where to schedule a container. So as a user, you tell the master, schedule this container. But you don't say, schedule this container to this node, because you don't think in terms of nodes anymore. You don't think in terms of machines anymore. You just tell master, schedule this container, and then master, using the scheduler, looks at the nodes and figures out where to schedule that for you. So that becomes Kubernetes' problem, not your problem anymore. And finally, there's also something called controllers. These guys, they basically make sure that the containers that are scheduled and running, they continue running. And let's imagine if this node goes down, then the controller will detect that this node went down, and all the containers that are on this node will be moved to other nodes as well. So that's what Kubernetes cluster looks like. And in this new world, in this new containerized Kubernetes world, a microservice looks like this. So first, you write your code, and then you put your code in a container, so that's your code, and then you push that container to some registry. So it tests on a public registry. So this is usually a Docker Hub, or it can be Google Cloud container registry. So your container lives there, and from there you create what's called a pod. A pod is the smallest unit that Kubernetes schedules. So usually it's a single container, but you can also put multiple containers in the pod as well. So you define your pod, then from there you tell Kubernetes what you want to be true. So in this case, there's something called replication control in Kubernetes. We are saying replicas 3. So we are saying we want to make sure that there are 3 copies of these containers running at all times. Right? That's what we are saying to Kubernetes. Then Kubernetes will look at the nodes that we have, and it will figure out where to create these pods and schedule them. So we'll create these pods and schedule them on these nodes. But as a user, you don't care. That's Kubernetes' job to figure out where to schedule them. And once you have your pods, you can label them. So for example, in this case, we are labeling them as raw frontend or raw backend, and environment as like pod or test. So that's how you can define your pods. And once you're ready to expose your pods to the outside world, you can create a service. A service is kind of like a load balance for your pods. You can basically group pods under the service, and people from outside, they will talk to the service, get to your service, the service is a stable IP, and from there we'll get to your pods. So in this world, a microservice is a combination of your container and a combination of what Kubernetes provides. So a replication controller, watching your pods, creating and watching your pods, and service exposing your pods. So it's a combination of both, right? It's not just your code anymore. Alright. Any questions so far with containers and Kubernetes? Is it clear why they exist? Yes? Okay. Let me know if something's not clear. But even though we have all these great things with Kubernetes and containers, it's still not enough. And the reason is, let's say you want to do logging. How do you do logging? We which framework do you use? And where do they block? And how do you show them? If you want to do tracing, so you have microservices, I mean, you want to see how long it takes this microservice to call that microservice, and if there's any faults in that call. So you want to do some kind of tracing. How do you do it? Which frameworks do you use? If you want to do dependency visualization, so you have this microservice cluster, and they have dependencies on each other, right? You want to visualize that. Which tool do you use? Fault injection. So let's say you have a chain of microservices, microservice A calling B, B calling C, and you want to make sure that they behave properly. If one of the calls fail, how do you test that? Ideally you inject some kind of fault and see what happens, right? So that's fault injection. And how do you set traffic policies? So how do you make sure that microservice B is only called from microservice A and no one else? Do you set network rules? Do you do it in the software? How do you do it? So there's all these things that you still need to do, and containers and Kubernetes doesn't help you for that. That's why we have Istio. So this is the logo for Istio. It's another Greek word. For some reason in the open source world they like Greek words. And the good thing is that Istio means, I think it means sails in Greek, sail in Greek. That's why we have the sailboat kind of thing. And the good news is that it's not mispronounced. It's correctly pronounced this time. So yeah, that's great. So now let's go through Istio at the very high level. What is it trying to solve? At the very high level, I think Istio has two goals, at least in my mind. The first goal is that it's about community maturing and gathering around common tools. So as I mentioned, you can use many frameworks for logging, you can use many frameworks for tracing, you can do it in many different ways, right? And people do it in many different ways. And in some ways it's kind of frustrating because it happened to me, like when I'm working on a project, I'm using certain tools in certain ways, then I move to another project, and they do it differently, so I have to do the same thing, but it's slightly differently, so I have to rerun everything, and that's always frustrating to me, because I know what to do, it's just a little bit different. But with Istio, basically the communities are coming together, and they're saying, this is the right way of doing things, so let's just do it this way. And it gives you the defaults to do it that way. And if something doesn't work for you, it also makes it pluggable. So if you don't like, say, tracing that Istio provides, you can plug in your own trace. So it gives you a framework as well, so that you can install what you have and plug in what you have. So that's number one. And then the second thing is, it's about decoupling application code from underlying platform and policies. So when you write an application, it should only solve the problem that you want to solve. It shouldn't care about where it's running. It shouldn't care about that it's running on Kubernetes or it's running on Mesos. And it shouldn't also care about the policies. So your microservice should not really care about who's calling itself, or your microservice should not care about network policies, right? Someone else should manage that. But unfortunately, since we don't have good frameworks to manage these things, most of the time the application code ends up getting details about the platform, and it ends up getting details about the policies around the microservice, and that's not great. But with Istio, we can decouple that, and I'll show you how that works in Istio. Okay, so these are the high-level goals. In terms of details, as I mentioned, Istio, it's a Greek word that's pronounced correctly this time, is sail. It supports Kubernetes today, so it's built on top of Kubernetes, but it's supposed to support also other container management platforms like Mesos or CloudFoundry. I'm not sure, I haven't checked Mesos and CloudFoundry yet. I think it's in beta or alpha stage, but it works on Kubernetes today. In terms of what it provides to you, it gives you metrics, so all the metrics that you want in your application to keep track, logs and traces, and dependency visualization through microservices. It gives you service identity, so every microservice has an identity, and then you can use that identity to set up rules between different microservices. It gives you traffic management, so you can control the traffic between your microservices dynamically. You can change them on the fly. And it also provides policy enforcements. So if you set rules between two microservices, such as, let's say you want to say, this microservice can only receive requests, 5 requests per second. You can set rules like that, and Istio makes sure that those rules are being enforced. So So you don't have to enforce it yourself, it still does that for you. So that's why it provides it very high level, and we'll go through these one by one to get them in detail. Alright, so let's imagine that you have this microservice cluster. So you have the users talking to a front-end microservice, and then maybe front-end is talking to some authentication service, and then maybe this authentication service is talking to some external class SQL to get authentication information. Then maybe front-end is also talking to some pictures microservice, and maybe some payments service as well. And then this payments may be talking to some external payment system as well. So you have this internal microservices, you have some external dependencies, you have some database that you're relying on, and you want to use Istio in this environment. How does it work? So when you install Istio, this is what you get. So you realize like all these proxies. So what happens is that first of all, Istio installs an ingress. Ingress is kind of like a gateway to your cluster. So all the traffic goes through the ingress. And then it also installs what's called proxies. So every microservice will get a side proxy to it. And all the traffic will go through the proxy. So ingress, so first traffic from clients will go through the ingress. And then ingress, instead of calling the front end directly, will call the proxy directly. And then the front end needs to make the call to the pictures. It's the proxy of the front end that will call the proxy of the pictures. So all the traffic goes through these proxies. And the reason is because by having traffic go through these proxies, Istio can do all the magic basically behind the scenes without you having to change your code. And we will get those and what those are. Alright, so how do you install Istio? First of all, you need to have a cluster to install Istio. So in this case, I'm using gcloud container clusters create. So I'm creating a Kubernetes cluster in Google Cloud. So I'm just creating a Kubernetes cluster. I'm saying I'm going to use standard machine types. I'm going to use 4 nodes, so I'm going to have 4 nodes in my cluster. And my zone is Europe West, because that's where I'm based. And the only thing that I need to do is enable clusters alpha. So I need to enable some alpha features in Kubernetes to make sure that Istio works correctly. So with this, I will have a cluster running in Europe. And then I also need to set up a cluster role binding. So this basically sets up the settings for Istio, the settings in cluster, so that Istio can do its magic. Like it sets up the security rules and stuff like that to make sure that the cluster is ready for Istio. So you basically just create your Istio with alpha, and then you set a cluster binding like this, and then you're ready to install Istio now. That's all it takes. Now to install it, I have a video that I'm going to show you. So let me just pause here for a second. Yep. So here I am in Google Cloud Console, and I have this Hello Istio cluster that I created. And I want to install Istio to this cluster. So what you do is that first I open my shell, and then I need to install, I need to get Istio latest version. So what I'm doing here is that I'm doing curl, HTTPS, git.io, get latest. And I want to make sure that I'm installing a specific version of Istio, so I'm saying I'm passing Istio version 0.4.0. That's the one that existed like last month when I made this video. And this is downloading Istio 0.4.0. I think the latest one today is 0.6, so there's two more versions after this. It's changing a lot. Every week there's a new version. So once this is downloaded, Istio comes with installers for different platforms, including Kubernetes. So we'll just go there and install it there. So I have Istio 0.4. First, I'm going to add, there's a command line tool called Istio CTL that you can use to manage Istio. So I'm adding that to my path. So I did that. And then we're going to just start installing now. So what we'll do is we'll set kubectl. Kubectl is a command line tool to manage Kubernetes. So I'm saying kubectl apply, then I'm pointing to the install folder in Istio and Kubernetes folder in Istio auth.yaml. So I'm pointing to a YAML file basically. And now this is installing all the Istio components. So you can see that it's installing Istio Mixer, Istio auth, Istio all the always addressed your needs. So what's happening is that it's going through this YAML file and it's just installing all the components of Istio on Kubernetes. And one thing to keep in mind is that Istio gets installed into a separate namespace. So in Kubernetes, there's different namespaces that you can create. So there's basically separate sections within your cluster. And Istio creates its own Istio system namespace, so it doesn't affect anything else. So if you have your application running already in your default namespace or some other namespace, it's not going to affect anything because this will create a new namespace and it will store everything in there. So this will keep going a little bit. And I'm also installing Istio auth. So what that means is that when I create my pods, I want to make sure the proxies that I show you, they're created automatically. And they also have service-to-service authentication enabled between them, right? So that's why I'm installing Istio auth, because that's what happens when you install that. But yeah, so this Istio auth installed the Istio components, and the Istio initializer will install the fact that, you know, when I create my pod, the proxy will also be created automatically. So that's what this enables. So if you look at the namespace, kubectl get service Istio system, you can see that there's Istio ingress, Istio mixture, Istio pilot, they're already installed in that namespace. And if I do kubectl get pods and look at the namespace, we'll see that the pods are running as well. So ingress, certificate authority, initializer, mixture, pilot, and we'll look at what these mean. But basically that's all it takes. It just create a cluster, run a command, and install Istio, which is pretty easy. Alright, so now let's talk about the actual building blocks of Istio, the Envoy, Mixer, Pilot, and Istio auth. So these proxies are called, they're also called Envoy. That's where all the magic happens. So all the traffic goes through the proxy, and all the traffic from service to service goes through the proxy. For me, Istio is basically these proxies, because that's where all the magic happens. Then there's also things like pilot and mixture and Istio auth. These guys, they try to support proxies. That's what their role is about. But they don't really do the work. The work is done in the proxy. So the pilot, it manages the proxies. So as a user, you can tell pilot what you want, and it converts those rules into configurations, and it pushes those configurations to the proxy. So it's kind of like a glue between the users and proxies. As a user, you tell pilot what you want, and then that tells it to the proxies. Mixer is about policy checks and telemetry. So every time proxy wants to call another proxy, it will check with the mixer. It will say, you know, can I make this call? Do I have the quotas for to make this call? And mixer will it keeps track of all the rules, so it will check and say yes or no, and then when the proxy gets the go ahead, then it will make the call. So that's the policy check part, and it also keeps track of the telemetry. So these proxies, as requests come in, they will keep track of some metrics. But at some point, these metrics, they need to be correlated. So that's where this happens. In the mixture, we correlate all the metrics and then display them in the dashboards. And then finally, Istio auth. This is all about giving proxies identity, so each service has a unique ID, and you can also enable service-to-service authentication with the proxies, so Istio auth basically manages that, make sure that happens. Alright, so proxy is a C++ proxy. It's supposed to be high-performant, meaning even though all the traffic goes through the proxies, the performance is minimal, so it doesn't really affect your web services. It supports, the Envoy support HTTP1, HTTP2, and gRPC as well. gRPC is a high-performance binary-based protocol, came from Google. That's much more efficient than HTTP and JSON, so you can also use that. So the Envoy does the service discovery, load balancing, TLS, health checks, metrics, all that kind of stuff. So all the stuff that you want, yeah, they happen through Envoy. And they're deployed as sidecars. What that means is that when you deploy your container, then these proxies are automatically created and added to your pod. because in Kubernetes, I mentioned before, there's this notion of pods, right, that includes your container. But in this case, it will include your container, and it will also include your proxy that manages the traffic for you. But that's done automatically, so you don't have to worry about creating that yourself. So that's what Envoy is, and then I want to talk about Pilot. It basically enables service discovery for Envoy. It does traffic management capabilities, so if you want to do A/B testing or canary deployments, you tell to Pilot, and Pilot makes that happen, and we'll look at some examples of that. It enables a lot of resilience features, so timeout and retries and circuit breakers, stuff like that, you can configure through Pilot. And lastly, it converts from rules to Envoy rules. So there's a rules API that you use as a user to tell Pilot what you want, and Pilot changes that to Envoy specific rules. Yeah, so this is how it looks like. So as a user, you use the rules API, and then that rules API, Pilot takes that and pushes it to Envoy as Envoy rules. The other important thing to mention is that Pilot has an adapter for different platforms. So it takes the rules that you specify and it converts those rules to the platform that you're running on, right? So if you're running on Kubernetes, it will convert it to Kubernetes rules. But if you're running on Mesos, it will take that and convert it to Mesos rules as well. And this is really nice because Envoys, they don't really need to know anything about the platform, you know, because there's an Envoy API as well in Pilot. And the Envoy will ask through that API to Pilot, and the Pilot will figure out how to answer that from the underlying platform. So it makes it really pluggable. And as a user, you don't know the platform, and as Envoys, they don't know the platform. Pilot is the only thing that knows about the platform and does a conversion. And then Mixer is, as I mentioned before, it does precondition checking. So every time an Envoy wants to call another Envoy, it will ask Mixer whether it can do that. It manages quotas. So if you set quotas on microservices, that will be managed by Mixer. And it does telemetry reporting. So all the telemetry that goes through your Mixers will be reported through Mixer. And Istio-Auth is all about authentication. So your services get strong-ended identity, they get service-to-service authentication, and also the end-user authentication happens through Istio-Auth as well. All right, so let's just deploy an application. So we got our cluster, and we installed Istio on top of the cluster. Now let's deploy an application and see how that application is managed by Istio. And Istio comes with a sample application called book sample or something like that. So we'll just take a look at that. So you're in Cloud Shell. What I'm going to do is I'm going to use kubectl create dash f samples book info. So that's the sample application. And just point to book info.yaml. So this is creating service deployment. So I'll just pause here for a second. Let me go back. That's the great thing about videos, you can pause. Go back and skip. Right. What I want to show you here is this. Right. So when I installed the Book Info application, it created a service. So there's a details service, there's a details v1, version 1 deployment, then there's a rating service, then there's a ratings v1, and then there's a review service, and then there's reviews version 1, version 2, version 3. Right. So I'm basically creating bunch of microservices, and some microservices they only have one version, like details and ratings, but then some microservices they have multiple versions, so these are the different versions that you might have in your system, so those are also being installed. The reason why I show this is that, first of all, this is a combination of multiple microservices, and secondly, there's multiple versions, and we can actually change rules to use different versions for those microservices. That's what we'll do next. So it's good to understand that. Alright, so once that is installed, you can say kubectl get service. You can see that we have product page, ratings, reviews, details, services running already. Then if you do kubectl get pods, you should see that pods are running, and this one is being initialized still. And then if you do another pods, now they're all there. So the app is running. As I mentioned, everything goes through ingress in Istio. So first we need to get the ingress IP. So when I do kubectl get ingress, I can see the IP here. That's where I can get to my service. So I'm going to just set a gateway URL variable and point to the IP. And I'm going to use that to get to my microservice. So what I'm doing here is I'm doing a curl to that gateway URL, and it's giving me 200. So my product page is already running. And if I open a tab, we should see an application. So if you go to the IP, now we are hitting the ingress IP and we are going to the product page. So we are hitting the product page microservice. And this is a combination of multiple microservices. So there's book info, book details, book reviews. They're all using different microservices. And one thing you realize is that this book reviews is changing. The reason why it's changing when we refresh is that it's using different reviews. Versions, you reverse has three versions, and when you refresh, it's getting a different microservice, that's why it's changing. So this is the app, and we're going to change this app through Istio. So now what we're going to look at is that, so we install Istio, basically Istio, we install our application, now we can add add-ons. That's the great thing about Istio, is that it's very pluggable, so you can add on whatever you want. So we're going to add Grafana. Anyone use Grafana here? No? Oh, okay, cool. So that's for analytics and monitoring, so you can add that on. We're going to add Prometheus for querying the metrics. We're going to add on Zipkin for tracing, so when you get the product page, you can see all the calls that's happening underneath and how long they're taking. So that's Zipkin. And we're going to add the service graph. I like this because this tells me, my cluster tells me, you know, I have the ingress, I have the product page, version 1 is calling other services, and I have different versions of the reviews. So I can see this service graph, and it's real time, it updates in real time. So we're going to install this as well. So let's see how we install it. By the way, how am I? Is time okay? Am I? Yeah, it's fine. All right. Okay. I don't have this luxury usually. They usually tell me, yeah, 5 minutes left. I'm like, oh, no. I always have a problem with time. Alright, so to install, we use kubectl apply, install Kubernetes add-ons, and Grafana. There's a YAML for it. So this creates Grafana service and deployment. Same thing with Zipkin. Same thing with Prometheus. And same thing with the service graph, so it's very easy to add. And if you want to plug in something else, you can create your own YAML and plug that in as well. So we'll do this, and then we'll take a look at them one by one. So now, yeah, we just added all of this like that. And if you do get pods and look at the Istio system namespace, we should see already that we have the service graph, Zipkin, all of that running. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy some code to send some traffic to product page. So I'm sending some requests to the product page so we can see our metrics. So as I'm sending that, now I'm going to set a tunnel from my shell to port 3000 where Grafana is running. So I'm basically mapping port 8080 from here to 3000 where the Grafana is running, and now I'm opening port 8080, and now this is displaying Grafana. So if you go to Grafana, there will be an Istio dashboard here, and if you click on it, then we should see our microservices and their metrics already being populated. And this is nice, it will come up. This is nice because I haven't changed my code. I haven't done anything special in my code. The only thing I did is that I installed Istio, and all the traffic goes through the proxies, and because of that, I get all of this for free. So all my product page, reviews and everything, I get nice dashboards, I can see, I can just visualize it like that. So let's grab Anna. The next one is Zipkin. So Zipkin is about HTTP tracing. So I'm again doing a port forwarding from port 3001 to port 8081, so I can get it from the browser. So that's Zipkin, and if we search for a product page, for example, find traces, boom, component, we should see more details. Again, I haven't changed anything in my code, just because of ECDL magic. And the next one is, let's see, for metrics. So that's for looking at your metrics. So I did the mapping again, opened it up. And because we have Envoy and Envoy reporting metrics to the mixer, and through the mixer and Prometheus, I can access my metrics. So if you look at ECDL request count, you should see some numbers, and you can visualize them in a graph as well if you want. So I'm just going really fast here just to give you an idea of what kind of stuff you get for free. But you can look at this in more detail if you want later. And lastly, my favorite is the service graph, because I always like to visualize my cluster, right? And it's always difficult, but with this, I get a cluster visualization for free, and it's real time, it updates in real time as well. So if you look at that service graph, I need to change some URL. So envoys talk to other envoys, they don't talk to services directly. And same thing, like a service calls a service, so it uses services URL, but under the covers, it goes through the envoy. And I'm going to show that right now, actually. But everything happens through the envoys, and you can decide what kind of communication you want. You can decide whether it's HTTP 1, HTTP 2, or JIPC.
Maybe just
rephrase,
because what changes do you need to do to an application so they can actually use Envoy?
Nothing. That's the key.
Okay, you don't how they are going to, how your initial application is going to realize that actually it has Envoy
No.
Available.
Your application has zero knowledge that it's running with an ECDL, and it has zero knowledge that there's an Envoy.
Okay, but Envoy needs to know that he has certain endpoints. To use.
And it does, like it knows that through pilot, and it knows that, so through pilot it figures out which other envoys to call, and which calls to intercept. But it's all done through ingress, envoy, pilot, your application doesn't change at all.
Okay, yeah, but when you arrive like in envoy, you have an endpoint like hello world,
yep.
And hello world could be in your your source code function a word, or could be just hello.
Yep.
How Envoy knows which one to call send it? That's my question. I can visualize how that connection is really happening.
So
calling.
Yeah. I mean, from the service, you would say I would talk to, say, product service. So you make a call as if you're making a direct call, but then that is intercepted by Istio and then go and routed through the Envoys. So there's a lot of magic that happens under the covers to intercept
okay.
that.
Okay, so Envoy always intercepts the TCP request.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So
yeah. The network is the network is handled totally by Istio. So,
okay.
But the service doesn't know that. Service just makes a regular call to a service, not IP but DNS, and then from there, like, it's intercepted and routed through the Envoys.
Okay. And so that's why you actually can wrap an external system like Gmail with Envoy, because Envoy can intercept that.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah. And that's the whole point. And because we want people to use Istio without having to change anything. Right, and this pattern actually, like installing a what's called a sidecar next to your container, it's a pattern that was used at Google for a long time. So people, and it worked really well for us, and that's why when we created Istio, we said, okay, this is a good pattern, so we'll just make sure that people also have this pattern in this new project. And you see that a lot in Google, like we try something internally for a long time, and when it works great, like Kubernetes concepts or Istio concepts, that we make them open source in a project like Kubernetes or Istio. Which is nice because that means that these are tested and successful concepts, not someone's like wild ideas, and you don't know whether it will be successful or not. So let's go through the traffic management and then we'll wrap it up after that. So traffic management basically decouples traffic rules from your application. Right, so your application doesn't know anything about the rules in your cluster. You all specify it through Istio. So what does it do? You can do dynamic request routing, so you can do A/B testing, and I'll show you an example of that. You can do discovery and load balancing between services. You can do failure recovery, so you can have failures and then recover from the timeouts and rewrites, and you can set circuit breakers and stuff like that. And you can do fault injection, so you can inject faults into your traffic and see how your microservices. So to look at the details, for example, in this case, we have a service A, and it wants to talk to service B. So it makes a call, just like I explained, like make a call to service B, example.com. This gets intercepted by the Envoy, and then Envoy, through the pilot, it figures out where service B should be, and then it makes the call to that Envoy. All right, so, but the key thing here is that you can set rules in pilot, and you can say, I want 99% of my traffic to go to this version of my service, and I want 1% to go here, because maybe this is your new version, like 0.2 alpha, and you want to do like a canary deployment basically, make sure that this works as well. So you can set a rule like that, but then service A doesn't know. Service A only calls service B.example.com, and then Envoy just checks with the pilot, and then from there it gets routed, like depending on the rules. So you can do things like this.
The secret breaker, where you can do it? I mean, you can do it like in the entry point, like I'm going to handle the secret breaker, and I'm going to give you the correct answer using the secret breaker, or you can do it in your co-located Envoy index point. Like, I'm going to call that external service, but before to call that external service, I'm going to define that secret breaker. When is that handling the first case or in the second case? Or both?
So I think I haven't looked into details of circuit breaker, like how it's implemented in Istio, but my basic understanding is that it basically enables you to call a service a number of times, and then if the service is not responding, it stops calling, but behind the scenes it will keep checking, and when it comes back online, then it will route the traffic again. But it won't keep calling the service all the time, so your code won't be able to keep calling the same source because there's a circuit now that's broken. So it handles that, but I don't know the details of it. I won't go into the details of it yet. Okay, and then you can do other things. For example, you can say Istio can look at the headers. So for example, you can say user agent Android and user agent iPhone, and Istio can look at that and it will route traffic using those headers as well, which is nice. There's discovery and load balancing. So what this means is that Pilot uses Kubernetes to discover services, and then when service A wants to call service B, it goes to the envoy, and through the envoy, since Pilot knows about the services, it will be able to load balance between them. So I guess the point of this slide is that Istio relies on the underlying platform for service registration and discovery. So Kubernetes provides that, and then Pilot uses that. The failure recovery, so you can do things like timeouts and bounded retries. You can specify how many retries you should do and what their timeout budgets should be. You can do health checks. You can limit the number of concurrent connections. So if your microservice needs to have a limit, you can set that up. And then circuit breakers. But as I mentioned, you can't really play Istio like that. But the circuit breakers, as I mentioned, I haven't looked into details yet because there's so many things to know and they're quite detailed that I don't know how it's implemented in details. And phone injection. So let's imagine you have these microservices calling each other and then you have these limits. So this microservice has a limit of 3 retries and 100 milliseconds, and then this one has 2 retries and 200 milliseconds for whatever reason. You can actually inject delay in your calls. So maybe here you want to inject 300 milliseconds as delay, and in here you want to inject 400, and see how they behave. See if it recovers, or see if they behave the way they're supposed to behave. So this is really useful, because I had so many problems in my previous companies where everything works great, but then something is delayed, and it doesn't work, and trying to simulate that is such a pain. And it always only happens in production. You can't test it in production, so trying to test that in your internal environment is priceless, you know? So this gives you a framework to do that. This would have saved a lot of time and effort and frustration 5 years ago. So if you haven't done this kind of stuff, you're lucky. Just use this and yeah. Alright, so last demo. I want to show you some of the route changing routes and how that works. So here we are again in Istio. We are using Istio CTL command. So I'm saying Istio CTL get routes. And when I do refresh, one thing you realize is that it's refreshing these, so your color is changing, because every time I refresh, it's hitting a different review surface. So that's why it's changing. And when I do get routes, you see that there's no routes. So I haven't set any special routes in my application yet. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to say Istio CTL create. And then I'm going to point to a YAML file that defines some route. And in this route, it says route rule all v1. So I'm setting all my microservices to version 1 of that microservice. So that's how you create the rule. And when you look at the rule itself, you realize that all the microservices are pinned to version 1. Now if you go back here and refresh, you'll see that this doesn't change anymore because we are always going to version 1 of this, right? We set that as version 1, it's not going to change. Now if I want to create another route, so in this case I'm going to again use Istio CTL create and then samples, and in this one I'm going to pin, let me try to remember this one, I think I'm going to pin a certain user to a certain version. So I'm going to sign in as a user, the user is JSON, and JSON gets version 2 of the microservice. So if you do refresh, then this is not going to change either, because now JSON is pinned to this version. And then if I delete this, so I'm deleting the route rule. And this is all happening in dynamic, right? That's the great part. So now I'm deleting the rule for V1. So now they're not pinned to version 1, and I will delete the rule for JSON as well. Yeah. And then if you go back to our app and sign out and do a refresh, then you will see that this is going to update again. Yeah. So I created a rule, and then I get rid of the rule dynamically without changing anything in the network or without changing anything in my application. So that's how routing works. And the very last thing is, if you want to get rid of everything, because you played with Istio and you want to get rid of it, you want to delete Istio, what you can do is you can just say, so these are the Istio system pods that we installed. You can just say kubectl delete, then point to our application. So that's the application that we installed. Delete that. Now this is deleting the application. And once the application is deleted, I can delete Istio just using that. So basically the point is, since Istio installs into its own namespace, you can add it easily, but if you want to get rid of it, it's also just get rid of the namespace and everything is gone. So it's very easy to add and remove from your cluster. So we don't have to wait for this, but I'll just go further. To delete Istio, basically I just say, you know, I just pointed this YAML, I just say delete, and now it's going to go through all these Istio deployments and delete them. And I think I need to delete also the other one, the Istio, I forgot what it's called, Istio initialize, initialize is the one that installs sidecars, and then auth is the one that installs everything else. And then, yeah, just like that, Istio is gone. So if you don't like it, just delete it. You don't have to use it. I'm just telling you what I know. But it's up to you to decide if you want to use it or not. Alright, clean up. Yeah, that's it. So if you want the slides, use the Twitter. And yeah, thanks very much for being here on a Saturday morning.